Today, I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Aseem Inam to the audience here. Dr. Inam has been ex-student from CEPT University when it was not a university at the School of Architecture. And presently, he's the director of TRULAB at Canada. And he was earlier the distinguished visitor at the University of Toronto and is also the founder director of the highly motivative MA Theories of Urban Practice and Program at Parsons School of Design in New York. Dr. Inam has practiced as an architect in urban design and planner in Brazil, Canada, France, Greece, India, Morocco, and many other places. Today's lecture that he's going to talk to us about is about transforming cities and transforming urbanism. We request him to take the stage and deliver the talk. Which, as I discussed earlier with him, it's scheduled for about 45 minutes. After that, we can have about 15, 20 minutes for a conversation, questions, discussion, and the floor is open. Please, we welcome Dr. Inam.
Thank you for that introduction. It's really a pleasure to be back as a former student of CEPT. It's wonderful to see old friends here, the batch of 79 that I was part of, very proud to be part of the group. I would like to especially thank Dr. Bimal Patel and Dr. Vishal Dubey for hosting this talk. So I want to explain, before I start my talk, I want to explain the title a little bit, especially the word transformation, because it's used a lot that it has almost lost its meaning, it's as you know. So I take the idea of transformation very seriously, and I acknowledge that it's actually very difficult to truly transform a city. A lot of people in our fields think transformation is just the physical change. I don't think that's true. So my approach to transformation is very specific. First of all, it's aspirational in the sense that it aspires to greater scales to maximize benefits. So it's not just about the project or the site, but it's beyond that. Second, transformation involves systemic strategies that go beyond project-based thinking. So you have to think about systems of how cities are produced and reproduced. And third, it's deeply structural rather than only physical. By structural, I mean it has to be socioeconomic and even political. So my work is developed on this notion of research as practice. What do I mean by that? As an urbanist and activist scholar practitioner, I find that while cities are amazingly multi-layered and multifaceted, a lot of the work that comes out of urban design, the design fields, perhaps even planning, actually fails to capture this wonderful complexity. So this is something I've been thinking about for a long time, and with about over 25 years of experience in practice, research, and teaching, I know that we can do much, much better than what we have done so far. So this is something I know that I share with many of you in the audience. The starting point for my work is always the material city, the physical landscape, the urban fabric. And a couple of reasons for that. First of all, cities are significant as the locus of people's direct engage with the material reality of the everyday world and their perceived meaning of social realities via the symbolism of urban artifacts. Even as the city is considered by theorists to be increasingly dominated by amorphous and expanded spaces of urban networks, people's visceral experiences and perceptions of their environment still matter greatly. So this is not about environmental determinism. I think we have to be very careful. I find that environmental determinism is coming back. No, architecture or urban design by itself does not shape people's behavior. But I think what's really critical is the what I call the material city is how most people experience the everyday world. So yes, places matter, cities matter, neighborhoods matter. And the second thing I'm saying is it's also not just the direct experience, but what these places symbolize for people. So the material city not only reflects the underlying structures of society, it also serves as one of the means through which these structures are sustained and legitimized. At a fundamental level, how primacies for urban interventions are established, how priorities are established, how scarce resources are allocated, and how cities are designed by urbanists and others all reflect the values and priorities of those in power. So the question I often ask, whether it's my practice or teaching, is who designs cities actually? The answer is power designs cities. So I approach this question of urban transformation, which is the main focus of my talk, through the lens of design and practice. Cities are our greatest design creations. Our love and concern for cities have resulted in amazing inventiveness as well as critical challenges. Let me say that again. Cities are, I think, our greatest creations. So in this design approach, many people have asked a question for a long time. What is urban design? There are many different answers which you see here on the screen. Many of these conventional definitions of urban design are problematic. For example, the first one, the morphological definition, describes urban design either as filling a gap between architecture and planning or being some sort of combination of these two fields. What is problematic is that it defines a field in terms of other fields rather than critically questioning and determining its own inherent purpose and nature. It's like defining music in terms of something else rather than questioning what the nature and purpose of that field itself is. Another example by which people have been designing this field is what I call lists of categories. So there was this article a few years ago, a short guide to 60 of the newest urbanisms. So now there is new urbanism, ecological urbanism, infrastructure urbanism, slum urbanism, so on and so forth. So for every situation, every challenge, there seems to be a new and different urbanism. I mentioned new urbanism, landscape urbanism, ecological urbanism, everyday urbanism, slum urbanism, infrastructure urbanism, and I could go on and on. Is that what we really need? I'm going to make a different argument in this presentation. So rather than ask what is urban design, there are a couple of problems with that question, what is urban design? First of all, whenever you pose something as what is architecture, what is urban design, what is planning, it does a couple of things. A what is question is always about the status quo, about what it is now. And of course, we must understand the past and the present, but what's exciting about our fields is about the future, rather than a static present. The other problem with asking a what is question, like what is urban design, or what is architecture, what is planning, usually the answer is a very narrow, professionally defined field. So this question, what can urbanism be, posits an interrogative exploration, so it's an interrogation, of the potential of a more inclusive field of thinking and action. So you notice I've changed the term from urban design to urbanism, and the talk will kind of explain what that's about. One of the main reasons I've changed it from urban design to urbanism is urban design has a lot of baggage. So for example, in the US, when you say urban design, what they mean is a very specific thing, which is post-World War II architectural projects that are based on real estate development. You see what I'm saying? It's a very narrow definition which has a lot of baggage, and I think we need to open it up much more, be much more interdisciplinary. So from the perspective of design and practice, urbanism is the amalgamation of city design and building processes and their spatial products. So city design and building processes. So city design and building, so I'm saying design and implementation are one and the same. And I think that's kind of problematic how we learn and teach in studios where it's design and then implementation is done with somebody else. It's these processes, that's the key thing to remember. It's the processes of city design and building and their spatial products. So the spatial products, which are buildings, streets, neighborhoods, do not come before the process. They are a result of the process of political policy making, of real estate development, of investment decisions, of so many things. So in this context, urbanists are practitioners who engage in willful, creative, and daily acts of designing and building cities. So in parallel, by shifting terminology from urban design to urbanism, I propose that we include in the realm of practice more than those conventionally trained to be urban designers, architects, landscape architects, and city planners, although all of us have a lot to contribute. In fact, some of the most cutting-edge ideas and most exciting practices come out of activist advocacy and nonprofit organizations. These include those working on issues of social and environmental justice, housing for the poor, transportation such as walking, bicycles, and mass transit, equal access to public space, legal rights for street vendors and public protesters, and democratic decision-making regarding the distribution of resources. So this question is future-oriented. It's not about the status quo. Secondly, it embraces a plural understanding. So I'm arguing we don't necessarily need a single narrow definition. But the most exciting is the third point. It talks about the possibility of reinvention. After all, we are in the 21st century where there's, as you know, there's technological change, but more exciting for me, there's social and political change that's happening. So to realize the full potential of this question, what can urbanism be, I argue for the essential role of theory. Theory is a systematically organized knowledge applicable to a wide circumstances, variety of circumstances and devised to explain, analyze, or predict a specified set of phenomena. At its fullest expression, theory represents a generalized abstraction of observations that serves as a guide to strategy and action. And this comes out of my research, which basically says, what's the most important tool for transforming a city? Is it technology? Is it money? Is it public policy? Is it community? It's actually our mind. So it's not money, but how we spend the money. It's not technology, but to what use we put it. It's not policy, but how we formulate and implement policy. So that's why theory, how we think, is the most powerful tool for transforming cities. And on-the-ground conceptualization of urbanism focuses not so much on what a city looks like as how a city works as a social entity. The examination of normative values are important in urban practice because, as the urbanist Kevin Lynch said, and I quote, decisions about urban policy or the allocation of resources or where to move or how to build something must be norms about good and bad. Short range or long range, broad or selfish, implicit or explicit, values are an inevitable ingredient of any decision. Without some sense of the better, any action is perverse. When values lie unexamined, they are dangerous, end quote. The third aspect of theory is integrating the reality that urbanism occurs with reference to a larger system of spatial political economy. As the theorist Alexander Cuthbert has written, and I quote, on the surface, urbanists, architects, planners may be involved in the somewhat mundane process of fulfilling a client brief, implementing a local environmental plan, or assembling development controls for some nebulous planning authority. At a fundamental level, and as a matter of their own legitimation, urbanists should remain conscious of their involvement in the historically generated ideological processes of reproducing urban space, end quote. So the work we do is never neutral, and I think we have to be very conscious of that. So from the perspective of design and practice in urbanism, the interesting question about theory is not so much about what is theory, but what can theory do? In other words, the performative aspects of theory. Kevin Lynch, in his deeply humanist book, Good City Form, provides perhaps what is the most breathtaking view of theory in urbanism. He provides an explanation of the ways in which theory is essential to the practice of urbanism. He suggests, and I quote, "A developed theory of cities will be simultaneously normative and explanatory, because it is impossible to explain how a city should be without understanding how it is. An understanding of how a city is depends on a valuing of what it should be." In other words, values and explanations are inextricable. So, moving forward from here, over the years, I've returned time and again to the values of pragmatist philosophy for understanding the relationship between cities, society, and fundamental transformation. Pragmatism as a philosophical movement began in the United States in the 1870s. Its overall direction was determined by the work of Charles Peirce, William James, and Chauncey Wright, as well as John Dewey and George Herbert Mead. The first use in print of the name pragmatism was in 1898 by William James, who credited Charles Peirce with having coined the term during the early 1870s. Pragmatism is a forceful challenge to the Cartesian-Kantian problematic to which analytic philosophers have long subscribed. Despite the differences within the movement, there are a number of characteristics that broadly define pragmatism as a philosophy. Perhaps the most important shared beliefs is that ideas do not exist as timeless, pre-existing, perfect forms. Unlike theories of knowledge that succumb to the Platonic urge by positing fixed, unquestionable grounds, pragmatists believe that indubitable epistemological foundations neither exist nor are necessary. Rather, ideas emerge contingently in response to particular needs and practices of people as they live out their lives in a given place and time. Ideas are labeled true when they enable us to get things done, that is, when they cope effectively with the world. Knowledge for pragmatists is constitutively social, so the social character of knowledge. Beliefs are collective products that are a response to the peculiar conditions and human needs found within a given social environment. However, to say that knowledge is social does not mean it's monolithic and singular. There is still room for individuality and diversity. At the same time, claiming that knowledge is social does not mean it's free-floating, that anything counts as truth. For knowledge to be true, under the pragmatist definition, it needs to be useful, that is, to enable humans to accomplish their purposes. If it does not, there will be no social agreement. The next characteristic is contingency. Clearly influenced by Charles Darwin is a belief in the importance and role of radical contingency, as well as a recognition for the need of adaptation in the face of unpredictability. Pragmatists believe that since ideas are provisional responses to particular circumstances, their survival depends not on their immutability, but their adaptability. Rather than denying probability by using words like necessity, inevitability, and certainty, or by trying to cordon it off by making it a separate branch of study, pragmatists argue that contingency should be seen as an opportunity. We should make chance work for us rather than against us. To deal with radical contingency and to find means for amelioration requires continuous experimentation. The nature of experiments is that many, if not most, will fail. The ambition is that new arrangements, new techniques, devices, institutions, methods, scientific or artistic endeavors, and in the case of urbanism, new design strategies would be successful to enable human flourishing. To do so requires openness, a willingness to listen, a democracy of hope. It is a democracy in the sense that it welcomes everyone to participate in the conversation, encouraging them to experiment by pointing in new directions and shaping new forms. The final characteristic I'm going to highlight of pragmatism is pluralism. In this characteristic, there is nothing that ensures final coherence. Difference, otherness, opposition, and contradiction should be juxtaposed, contrasted, brought together in opposition, made to groan and protest in their adjacency. Pragmatists insist that ideas do not add up to an ultimate single truth, pure and simple. It is more complicated, messier, more contingent, which is also the case with cities. No matter the many attempts to construct clean and pure conceptual models, different individuals and communities, in effect, operate within different and often incommensurable paradigms, resulting in potentially radically different interpretation. One should recognize the potential opportunities and gain from such interaction exchange through conversations and argument. So in other words, it is normal for cities and urbanism to be full of contradictions, opposition, negotiation. So what pragmatism does, this philosophical movement, is to help us understand that the most fundamental shifts in urbanism and transformation actually occur at the nexus of theory and practice. Based on these 25 years of research, teaching, and practice, I propose three radical shifts in urbanism. The first is beyond intentions, consequences of design. Second is beyond practice, urbanism as creative political act, and beyond object city as flux. So I'll just quickly, I'm going to flesh these out, but let me give you a little snippet. Beyond intentions. Most of our work, whether we're architects, urban designers, or planners, is based on intentions. So when we propose something, a building, a policy, a plan, it's an intention. It does not mean that's what will actually happen. For those of you who actually practiced, any proposal that you put through never ever gets implemented exactly the way you propose it. Things change, budgets change, clients change, the economy changes, politics changes. So what's interesting is not just to fixate on what we propose and intend, but also to look at what actually happens. What happens when we implement the plan? Even what happens when we build a building? For example, in my view, and this is something, you know, I think this is a mistake we all make, we analyze buildings and projects even before they're built. That's impossible. You should always do it after they're built, they've been occupied, they've been modified, etc. So I will now illuminate these ideas through case study analyses of transformative strategies. These analyses are a mix of research on projects all over the world and critical reflections on my own practice. So when I talk about case studies from my own work, it will not be presented as best practices, but I will talk about more critical reflections about that. So this is the first shift I'm proposing, beyond intentions, consequences of design. I'll let you read this for a minute, and then I'll talk about it. Can everybody see, even in the back? Okay. So this is the first fundamental shift I'm proposing beyond intentions, consequences of design. So what the pragmatist philosopher Charles Peirce is saying in this quote is that the whole meaning of a concept consists in the entire sets of its practical consequences. He's referring to an experimental method of mental reflection that leads to the verification of concepts and ideas. Furthermore, conceptions and consequences are discovered through the actual verification and living of life rather than only as an end result. So that's what I mean. You cannot really analyze a building or any project unless you've actually experienced it and you see what are its consequences. This consequential notion of truth involves not only a connection with reality for the individual investigator, but also involves social relations with the community of other investigators and believers of that truth. So now I'm going to illustrate this shift with a couple of case studies. This is the Central Artery Tunnel project called the Big Dig in Boston, which went through, there used to be an elevated highway through downtown Boston. They tore it down, they built a tunnel, and they created this green space and a lot of other things that I'll explain. As you can see, it's a wonderful new green space right through the heart of Boston. So there are two common narratives about this project, nicknamed the Big Dig, because it was a big tunnel, and some other things, which I'll explain in a little while. So there are two narratives about the Big Dig. There's a narrative of success. This narrative says the Big Dig is the most complex and technologically challenging highway project in the history of the United States, which resulted in reduced traffic congestion, improved mobility, reduced pollution, and the reconnecting of the urban fabric. The narrative of failure highlights the fact that it cost $14.6 billion rather than the $2.6 billion originally estimated, resulted in 15 years of non-stop construction and serious construction problems. So I propose a third analytical narrative. This question is it worth it? That's an important question to ask. There's another consequential question to ask, which is how can we now make it worthwhile? This leads to a fundamental shift in our understanding of transportation infrastructure. So one of the major consequences of the Big Dig was reconnecting the urban fabric of downtown Boston and creating new open spaces like the Rose Kennedy Greenway, which you see in the upper left. There were also three unexpected consequences as well. One is Spectacle Island, which you see in the lower left, which was a landfill, which is a euphemism for a garbage dump, which was where they used the soil, which was excavated from the tunnels, to put it on this garbage dump, and they converted it into a park. This was not planned early on, so where there was a garbage dump is now a park, and that's on the lower left. Another unexpected consequence was the Big Dig House, which you see on the lower right. Basically what they did, they recycled the old highway structures. You see the steel columns and beams, and they used that to build this new house. On the upper right is also the symbolism of a transforming city. This is the new Charles, the Zakim Bridge, which crosses the Charles River, and this has become the symbol of 21st century Boston. So this narrative for infrastructure of as consequential design is very powerful. The second case study that I'm going to use to illuminate the shift beyond intentions, consequences of design is this one that I'm sure many of you have visited, the India Habitat Center in New Delhi. This is an office complex of about 1 million square feet on 9 acres for the government of India's Housing and Urban Development Corporation, HUDCO. It contains a plethora of housing and infrastructure related institutions from the public, non-profit, and private sectors, including foundations and activist organizations. I was actually a member of the team that designed this project with Joseph Stein. I worked on the overall scheme with the rest of the team, and I facilitated the design of one part of the complex, which is you see in the lower portion there. This was the Tata Energy and Research Institute, which is called the D Energy and Research Institute now, TERI, where I did everything from programming to interiors to construction drawings to site supervision. So I have a special insight into the project. So the first consequence was something which was very rare and revolutionary in India in the 1990s. For the government to invite organizations who may be at opposite ends of the policy and political spectrum to share space because they're concerned with same issues. So there were government offices, but they invited activist organizations, private research institutions, foundations to share that space. I think that's very rare anywhere in the world to have people who work on housing and infrastructure issues, but perhaps from opposite ends of the political spectrum. So that was revolutionary, especially at that time. The other unconventional thing is that it's a very unconventional government office. So if you imagine any government building, then you see this image on the upper left, you'll know what I mean. So one of the ways it was very unconventional was the meeting spaces. So instead of having each office having its own meeting space, each office having its own parking, the meeting spaces were shared, the parking was shared, the events are shared, and even the eating areas are shared. On the lower left, what you see is the courtyards, which are shared landscape areas with microclimates that one has to cross to go from building to building to encourage social interaction. So you see in the blue the louvers. We designed them in a way that would let out the hot air, let in the natural light, but block the hottest sun in the afternoon. And it's with this vegetation and water, it's created these wonderful microclimates, which is what people cross through to go from building to building. And I've seen it myself. There's a lot of social interaction and discussion there. On the right side, now we are moving away from an office building to office campus, an ecological campus. This has also now become a hub of social and cultural activity. You see here art galleries, school children making drawings and paintings, auditoriums of public lectures, conferences and cultural events, and even music and dance performances. I would say it's a very unique office building to have all this. So the shift here is from government office building to ecological campus and vibrant urban center. The second shift I'm going to illuminate now is beyond practice, urbanism as creative political act. Sorry, I'm going to finish this first. Beyond intentions, consequences of design. So a couple of things, implications of this analysis. First of all, we invent concepts and objects of urbanism, and we can look towards the consequences as an integral part of the design process. We create, sometimes we think things are sacred. What is urban design? What is urbanism? But we invent them so we can reinvent them. The second point is being open to outcomes. That even if, for example, if a project doesn't turn out the way we wanted it to, is not always bad. It could actually be better. Sometimes as designers and architects, we think, oh, it wasn't exactly what we wanted, so it's a bad thing. Maybe it's better, maybe it's more open, maybe it has changed. So to reintegrate unexpected impacts of design strategies into practice, I think is very important to be open to these unintended consequences. The third point is the emphasis on time is essential, in which urbanism is an ongoing verb rather than definitive noun, right? So this kind of process of consequences, as I mentioned with the big dig, even though it's built and technically finished, actually the city is never finished. So you all always have consequences that we can design for. In terms of the case study, I just mentioned the big dig. Even completed projects can be made worthwhile after the fact, and we can redesign cities by redesigning institutions. So that was the revolutionary aspect of the India Habitat Center. So now this is the second shift, beyond practice, urbanism as creative political act, and I'll let you read that for a minute and then I'll talk about it. This quote by the pragmatist philosopher Richard Rorty has several implications. First, it is important to consider how the creation and production of the city is a political process writ large with moral choices, could be small or large moral choices actually. Second, the path towards admirable outcomes is riddled with moral struggle, and the moral progress that emerges is a result of our imaginative power. So we are constantly making moral choices, even the choices we think are technical, which material to use, how big something should be, this already embedded. But the second point I want to emphasize also, this question of struggle. If you want real change, fundamental transformation, it is struggle. That's something we don't talk about. We think just by design, by technical things, by policy, we can come to fundamental transformation. The third implication of this quote is this: in this political process and moral struggle, there is in fact room for far more creativity than we may presently imagine, because the traditions we confront have been invented and thus can be reinvented. So I'm going to illustrate these with a couple of case studies. This is a picture of shit. Do we use that word in India? S-H-I-T, shit. Hello. No, shit. So this is a picture of shit. This is a picture of transformation. Let me explain. So the Orangi pilot project in Karachi is a remarkable low-cost and community-based sanitation project in an informal settlement, which has now benefited over 1 million people. A medical doctor in partnership initiated the project with the local community. The diagram that you see is a hand-drawn map of the sewage system built lane by lane, alley by alley, over a period of 35 years. This is perhaps one of the most impressive examples of transformative urbanism I have come across in a very long time. The first thing I want to say about this project is transformation, that word that I mentioned in the beginning, must be contextualized in order to be understood. For example, this area in Karachi has a long history of extreme poverty, sickness, violence, and gender discrimination. It is indeed one of the toughest places to work in. So you see the conditions on the upper left, which are also true in many Indian informal settlements. A lot of sickness, a lot of filth, a lot of not just garbage, but raw sewage in the streets. Infant mortality was very high, people who get sick all the time. On the upper right, you see the construction of the sewage system, which was mobilizing the community pipe by pipe. So technically, it looks like it is a community-based, low-cost infrastructure, you know, the sanitation system. But the way they organized it, that people had to come together to work together. So the sanitation, you're fulfilling the sanitation demand, but you're also mobilizing community in the process. On the lower left, then they use this community mobilization for housing finance and support. As you know, in informal settlements, housing is a huge challenge. So they use that mobilization organization to work on housing. And probably the most remarkable is on the lower right. As you know, many of you know, in general in Pakistan, especially in Karachi, there's a lot of gender discrimination. So then this program, which was an infrastructure project, became a women's entrepreneurship and empowerment program where microfinance for small businesses like this woman making incense sticks. So here, technical design as revolutionary practice in extremely challenging context. And when I was in New York City, I had invited one of the key people that some of you might know who was involved in this project for over 30 years, Arif Hassan, who's trained as an architect but has worked with communities a lot. It was very interesting. He gave a talk just like this, and we were also videotaping him, and he had a mic just like this. We could barely hear him. I don't know if you've seen him. He's kind of short guy with white hair, and he's a really, this is going to be a video, right? Well, anyway, he's a really boring speaker. And I was sitting in the front, and I said, I can't hear him, even with the mic, what's going on? So I said, can you speak up loudly? I said it three times. He's such a soft speaker. And his slides, this is an amazing project. His slides were just like, here are some people meeting. Here's another slide of people meeting. There were like 20 slides of people meeting. I'm like, come on, man. You've come all the way from Pakistan. Show us what you've got. And then he would show technical slides of, you know, pipes, sewage pipes. And then I realized this notion of urbanism as a creative political act. In this context, with so much violence, so much poverty, so much sickness, and so much gender discrimination, their creative political act was to be dull and technical. Actually, they were mobilizing people, being very political. It was like, oh yeah, let's just talk about pipes. Oh, let's talk about toilets. Let's talk about sanitation. So it was actually a very brilliant move. They knew what they were doing, but it was disguised as a very technical design project. So this is the next project I'm going to talk about in terms of urbanism as creative political act. This is the Uptown BTS specific plan in Los Angeles. It's located about 12 miles southeast of downtown Los Angeles. And I was the project leader on this project. Our mandate was to come up with a strategy to attract investment in this historical core to raise the overall quality of design and development in this area of about 35 city blocks. My firm, our practice, was selected in a competitive process to work with the city and the community. So in my role as the project leader, I coordinated not only our multidisciplinary team, but as well dealt directly with the mayor, city council, planning commission, administrative staff, community groups, and citizens. I also ended up doing something completely unexpected. In order to make this project happen, I had to design the municipal budget. Something I'd never done before. I'd barely done my own household budget. I can explain later in the question and answer session how municipal budgets can be very powerful transformative design practices. So, a couple of things about this in the upper left. This notion of one of the things why we were selected is something I call designing democracy. We have a very transparent and participatory process. We have a week-long workshop where we're just not doing drawings, but decisions about roads, about parks, about budget are being made there. It's completely open. Anybody can come by. We had many public meetings. I personally met with 37 different groups and one-on-one with 112 individuals. And I'm sure many of you have done. I don't like to call it community participation, because community participation implies that the project is ours and then we allow the community to be in our project. I prefer to think of as community partnerships or collaboration where we join together and we make decisions together. It takes longer, it's more complicated, but it's worth it. So this kind of meeting with, I personally met with 37 different groups, 112 different individuals, and I'll be honest, it was absolutely exhausting. So it's nice to talk about it academically, but it's exhausting, and I would say it's absolutely worthwhile. So if you're serious about the democratic processes, you have to be very patient, a lot of energy, and it is absolutely worthwhile. On the upper right is a diagram where we, one of the biggest problems that came up, and this, I found this in many parts of the US, it's probably true in many parts of India, is when we work with the communities and we kind of dialogue with them about what are some issues and concerns they need to be addressed, one that comes up to the top is not enough parking. But we actually study the parking, we actually measure it, we find that there's too much parking. So how does one explain that paradox, that the community says there's not enough parking, but in fact there's too much parking? Does anybody know? Right places. What else?
Privatization of parking
spaces. Privatization rather than public parking?
Yeah.
That could be one, yes. What else? Sorry? Of parking. So this is a very interesting question. So when they say there's not enough parking, the knee-jerk reaction might be, oh yeah, let's do more parking. More parking structures, more parking lots. But you're right. The reason people want more parking, even though there's already too much parking, it's a question of location and timing. Everybody wants to park in front of the building at the same time. So if there's a shopping center and there's a big sale going on, they all want to be there on, you know, whatever, Saturday, Sunday, all at the same time. So it is a question of managing parking rather than designing parking structures. That's a major shift in how we think. So we came up with this parking management diagram, which I won't go into, but essentially one thing I'll mention very briefly is in the diagram on the upper right, the gray rectangles were proposed parking structures that we placed in this area in a way to make people walk more. So using parking to actually increase more pedestrian activity, one of the reasons was this area has a lot of really good local shops and local businesses and small stores, which if you just drive by, you hardly see them. So it's kind of strategically placing parking to actually make it more pedestrian friendly. We also used parking to generate dialogue and mobilize community around issues of common concern. So we didn't dismiss their parking concern, but that's a way to bring people together. That's really important, whether it's sanitation in the previous project or it's parking, something people really care about. So in summary, what we did was not design individual projects, but systems and prototypes, such as the park ones, system and management. It's by having different businesses. You might know in many parts of the US and even Europe, each business, when you start a business, an office building, a shop, you're supposed to provide parking for it, which means there's now huge amounts of parking. Those of you who've traveled, have seen photographs, you see parts of the US. Houston is one city which has huge, you go to downtown, huge amounts of parking. You think that city is inhabited by cars and the people are like in the backyard. So this creates these very unpedestrian, unfriendly environments. So how do you kind of reduce the amount of parking, you know, whether it's used for commercial purposes during the day, residents at night. There are many ways of sharing this parking. We also invented on the lower right this new building type called the liner. It's also called a wrap building, which is essentially a parking garage in the middle lined by offices and residences, and you see in the photographs, the point is not to have these big, gigantic, ugly concrete parking structures that you see in many parts of the US and other parts of the world, but to hide the parking behind what looks like a residential office or commercial building. The idea is to create an overall urban fabric where the human being, the pedestrian, is prioritized rather than the car. So in this, what I found, which is very interesting because of our very democratic design process, what we actually did was create a political constituency for urbanism. People, through this collaboration, understood what to demand of their leaders, their city leaders, in terms of the quality of projects that they need. And then also this thing I talked about, parking, flipping the parking problem around so that you actually use parking to get people to walk more. So what are the implications of beyond practice urbanism as creative political act? So when I say political act, I don't really mean, you know, the chief minister, the prime minister, the mayor. I mean the everyday politics of a city. Very often we run away from politics, but actually that's really how, especially in a democracy, things get done. Second, one of the most effective ways of practicing is to ask fundamental questions. Who has the power to actually shape cities, and how is that power wielded? I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, who designs cities? It's power who designs cities. And who has the power will differ in different contexts. The third is revolutionizing urbanism as creative political act by practicing temporary anarchy. By that, what I mean is I often come across professors, practitioners, who think they know everything. They know how a city works, how things should be done. Actually, none of us knows everything unless we are God. And even then, things change all the time. So temporary anarchy means kind of suspending our beliefs and actually looking at what's going on rather than having fixed ideas in advance. It's actually a very revolutionary way of practicing urbanism. So in the case studies, the first point, very often, this is changing, fortunately, those of us who are in the Global South, in Asia, Africa, Latin America, Central America, we look to the Global North, to US, Europe, etc. But actually, as the Karachi example, the Aurangi pilot project shows, there's radical resourcefulness happening right around us, and we can learn a lot from that. The second case study, flipping perceived problems into broader solutions, I already talked about the parking. So this is the third and final shift, beyond object city as flux, and I'll let you read that for a minute. The pragmatist philosopher William James makes three claims in this quote. First, he asserts the metaphysics of process, in the, which the philosophy of being is not about things, but things in the making. So what he means by things in the making is that even a building is constantly changing, evolving. I would say even second by second. It's weathering, it's modified, over its life it's falls apart, gets restored, etc. And this is especially true of cities. Second, he holds that reality is creative, growing, and living. This is again against. This is again an argument against fixed notions of how the world works. So reality is creative, growing, and living. Third, he claims that we can achieve an evolving understanding of reality as opposed to the archaic nature of standard conceptual analysis, that it's really important that our understanding of the world and how we do things also evolves. So the first case study that I'm going to illustrate this notion of city as flux is the Al-Azhar Park in Cairo. Al-Azhar Park is a 74-acre park located in one of the poorest and most historic parts of Cairo. The park cost $30 million and opened to the public in 2005, so it's been open for about 11 years. The project was managed by the Aga Khan Trust for Culture, and the landscape of the park that you see here was designed by a firm in Cairo called Sites International. So several things are important about this notion of city as flux in this project. First of all, on the upper left, you see the site. The site was a landfill, which is again a euphemism for garbage dump. But in historic countries like Egypt, India, things are measured in hundreds of years. So this landfill was over 500 years old, and it required being cleaned up. And then in the middle of the design process, you see in the upper left these kinds of white cylinders. The city of Cairo suddenly decided to put three gigantic water tanks. So the design itself had to change several times. On the lower left, what happened was, while they were cleaning up the site, they discovered this very historic 12th century Ayyubid wall, which is a big deal in a historic country like Egypt. It was the biggest archaeological discovery at that time. So what started out as a landscape architecture project for designing this park, they decided to preserve and renovate this wall. And then it became even more interesting because the site of this park is in a very poor area, they decided to use the historic renovation as a job training program for the people who live around there. So what started out as a landscape project became historic preservation, became job training. And then third, as they worked with the low-income residents of the area, they realized that there were a lot of very dilapidated houses in the area that needed to be fixed up. So they started a microfinance program to help with fixing up the housing, and then they opened a healthcare clinic. And you see some of that on the lower right. On the upper right, you see the park. One of the very interesting things about design of the park, if you've been to parks like Central Park in New York, etc., a lot of urban parks are what I call anti-urban. They pretend that it's a piece of countryside in the middle of a city. Here, it embraces very much its urbanity. You see the access to the historic monuments of Cairo and so forth. So it's a constantly evolving and I would say never-ending project from landfill to regeneration. So this is the notion of city as flux. This is the second case study I'm going to talk about. This is a studio that I designed and taught at MIT when I was a visiting professor there. And the main idea of this is developing the idea of urbanism as a verb, not just a noun, an unfolding process of becoming. And at this stage of my talk, I have a confession to make. I'm a professional comedian. Some of you get that joke. I am. I performed twice in Los Angeles, once in New York. And the reason I bring it up, there are several types of comedy. There's sketch comedy, stand-up comedy. The one I practice is called comedy improvisation. Some of you might know. Comedy improvisation is the hardest to perform because you're performing with a group. It's all improvised. You don't know what the other person is going to say. But the reason I bring it up, comedy improvisation is by far the most powerful form of creative collaboration I've ever seen. So my idea was to take comedy improvisation as a methodology for doing urbanism. So what I did was I taught the students, let me go to the next slide. I taught the students, so they did the studio where I taught them comedy, and I hate to admit it, they were funnier than I was, please don't tell anybody. And then, so they worked on the studio project, they did design, they worked on comedy improvisation. So as a result, the entire studio had to work as one team, and there was no leader. We talk about horizontal teams. By the way, it's going to become necessary, not desirable, necessary to collaborate more and more as our world becomes more complex, as our cities become more complex. I think this notion of the hero architect, which was wrong from the first place. Believe me, all these, even these big name architects, those of you who practice, they rely on people in their office to do the projects they do. It's always been collaborative. But I think now it needs to be really collaborative without kind of the star architect at the head. And part of it is learning to work horizontally. So one of the things in the studio was people had to work together without a leader. And it was amazing. They had some really heated arguments where I thought, I should say something, but I didn't. But they figured it out. So let me talk very quickly about a few of these diagrams. On the upper left is kind of a collective sketch. It's basically a visualization of their argument. We're looking at different options. The site is just south of downtown Boston, near Chinatown. It's sort of abandoned. What's interesting about the site is it's very controversial. Some people want affordable housing. Some people want market rate housing. In other words, there's no clear answer, which is a very common issue in cities. We like to make things, we like to make things clear, but actually things are much more messy. And one of the ways to sort it out is to rely on each other, is to talk it out, think it out, and to use each other as resources rather than, you know, kind of this kind of hierarchical thinking. So that's a visualization of their argument. On the lower left is a very interesting thing. The end result was not a master plan, was not an urban design project. But the way they approached it was to understand activities, not uses, not retail, housing, but what people do and what they can do. And you see kind of the yellow arrows in the lower left diagram. Basically what they're saying is this notion of city as flux. As the city evolves and the site evolves, the uses can evolve also. It has to do with housing and infrastructure. The diagram in the middle is how these changes might occur over time. What needs to be done first? So number one at the bottom is enhanced street networks. As you know, that some things have a bigger impact, last longer, like streets, infrastructure like that. Second is look at assets. So this kind of asset-based design, not just looking at what's wrong and problems, but what's right, what are the things we need to preserve, and so on and so forth. And on the right is a series of taking these kind of larger ideas and making them concrete through scenarios, existing, how the activities might occur, and then what that form might look like. So these are kind of what-if scenarios rather than a fixed master plan. So this is kind of creating generative scenarios and what-if vignettes. So the implications of this beyond Object City as flux, there are a few. First is I think one of the most important things we need to do is understand how fundamental urban change actually occurs. Not just superficial physical change, but what's driving that change. Is it speculation? Is it policy, etc.? A second implication is what is the relationship between ideas into strategic action? And I really believe that the nexus is really between theory and practice. Just doing is not enough. We need to really critically think about what we are doing, what's the larger picture, but obviously just thinking is not enough. So it's the intersection of the two, how big ideas we have about a city, about a future, translate into actual actions. I think that's really important for us to look at in terms of urban change. The third thing is we have this false notion of equilibrium. Everything is balanced, everything is in harmony. Actually, cities are always in disequilibrium. City as flux, it's always changing. And we don't really know what the future will bring, and I think we have to understand that and use it to leverage fundamental change. That there is constant change, so it's about how do you design for change, how do you manage it, I think that's an asset. In terms of the case studies I showed you is the power of going with a project where the needs are, that's the Al-Azhar Park. It started out as a very simple, beautifully designed park became historic preservation, became job training, became housing finance, became healthcare, who knows what it'll become. So not having fixed ideas about what the end result is, but being flexible and adaptive enough to go where the needs are. The second case study is design methodologies can emerge out of surprising sources like comedy improvisation. So I want to return to something I said at the beginning. So the first implication of this approach is a shift from asking what is urban design to investigating what can urban design be. A second implication is to develop new theories and practices of urbanism that lead to nothing less than urban transformation. So what do these three shifts that I've proposed add up to? Well, I want to return to what I started with, the notion of urban transformation. That's the whole idea. This is the approach to urban transformation. And to remind you that urban transformation in this context is aspirational, it's systemic, and it's structural. And we can do this because we know how to do it. It will take quite a bit of courage and patient effort to achieve it, but it is very much worth it, and we must start today. Thank you. So before we take questions, there's a little epilogue to this presentation. Just to explain, put things in perspective. This presentation is just a small part of my recent book, let me back up a little bit. So this is a body of work that is built on previous research. This was my first book. This looks at how cities are actually designed. You know, after I was trained as an architect and urbanist, urban designer, and I worked, I saw a mismatch between what I learned and how things actually work. So this is a comparison of Mexico City and Los Angeles, how cities plan when they're faced with crisis. So this was an earthquake in Los Angeles, earthquake in Mexico City. And the reason I picked these two examples is many of the examples are what's wrong, about failure. There are very few of success. So I want to see how was it successful. And I picked actually government agencies. I want to see how can bureaucracy be successful. So that was the first part in trying to understand how institutions design cities. Now this is about my most recent book, which this talk is based on. And this was like not just understanding how cities are designed by institutions, but how urban transformation actually occurs. This comes back to my notion of transformation is a word that's used all the time, almost to be meaningless, but I think we need to get much more serious about it. I'm now working on the third book, which is about Las Vegas, that people are very surprised by. But a couple of things. Las Vegas is a city I have been fascinated by. I don't gamble, it's okay. But it's a city everybody loves to hate, but people love to go to it. But my take on it is Las Vegas, because it's such an extreme city, actually reveals the true nature of contemporary urbanism. And I think we need to understand the juggernaut of capitalist development in order to propose radical alternatives, whether it's sustainability, livability, democracy. We need to understand these machines, kind of machine that produces these cities, including like Las Vegas in the middle of a desert. I think this happens in every city, maybe not in such extreme ways. So that was my next book. And then all these ideas are tested and fine-tuned through my teaching, through studios that we work with clients, but also through my practice. This is my own practice called TRULAB, where we test these ideas, and it's that's the experimental nature of it. All right, I'll be happy to take questions. Yes. Sorry, can you hang on 1 second? I think there's a microphone, so everyone can hear.
Hello. So as a legal researcher, this is also a really interesting talk. What I was interested in are the shifts that you mentioned. And the second shift, that the way you framed it, beyond practice, politics, and talks about creative politics, right? So the framing of it, this shift by itself seems to be agnostic to the kind of politics that we're talking about. Of course, your presentation and I suppose your work is informed by a certain kind of politics, which is pragmatism or even the global south, politics of global south, or even anarchy, as you mentioned. But would you say urbanism as it is practiced and the way you sort of rejected that, is it any less informed by politics? Or is it that it's informed by politics that is, I mean, less, has less concern for inequality or poverty? So what I'm saying, sort of a neoliberal politics. So is it the urbanism that you see has a problem? Is it not a political act in itself? And how do you then speak to people who, know that this is a political act, know the politics of it, and still have a preference for that kind of urbanism that is not that inclusive? So that's my question.
That's a really good question. Thank you for that. So when I say beyond practice, I'm talking about this conception of practice as a professional practice. Like, it's strictly professional, mostly technical, it's hierarchical, etc. So I say beyond practice because, yeah, there is a role to play for that. Yeah, practice does need to be technical, it has to be professional. The reason I say beyond is, yes, it needs to embrace the political. Well, first of all, it needs to understand the political. And that's why I say urbanism has created a political act. And first of all, it needs to understand the everyday politics of the city. By that, you're right. I don't mean ideologically right-wing, left-wing, center, whatever it might be. It's the everyday dynamics of a city, especially in a democracy. In the West, in the US and Europe, there's a lot of comparison between India and China. And the first thing I say is, however flawed it might be, at least India is a democracy. And we really need to cherish that. I spent 3 weeks in China. It's amazing what they're doing. It's both amazing and terrible. They want to put a high-speed train, you just put it through the farm. They want to build a city, they just build a city. It is not a democracy. I don't care, you know, how you couch it. So if we cherish our democracy, we need to understand how this politics works. So first is understanding that. Second, to engage with it. And again, I mean the everyday politics of communities and how different things, and not run away with it. So it's kind of a bigger point I'm making, that very often as architects, urban designers, planners, we say, oh, politics is somebody else's realm. No, it is political. But the third point I'm making, like through some of the examples here, is to be creative about it. Not just kind of, you know, old-fashioned, stiff, rigid, but be very creative, like in some of the examples I showed, where, for example, in that project in Karachi, what was looked like, oh, we're just designing sanitation. But actually, they were mobilizing the community. And the example I gave Arif Hassan, the reason he's such a dull speaker is you can shout from the rooftops, oh, revolution, we're going to change things. But he realized in that very violent and poor and context, they had a kind of quiet revolution, which taken 30 years, but they did it. So that's the kind of creative thinking, that there are different ways of being political, but ultimately it has to be about politics, because ultimately it's about power. Other questions? Yes, especially you.
We were classmates, so I have to check with him if I'm allowed to ask or not.
And I didn't pay him for this.
You should have. The question is, when you talk about using politics as a paradigm, as power as the shaping, primary element that shapes cities. I recall from my, the few things I remember from my urban design course was this concept of paradigm, which Robert Kuhn describes in his book about scientific, structure of scientific revolutions and all that. The two I do remember is the conflict paradigm, looking at a city as a equilibrium in various conflicts. The other is the systems paradigm. And to just put it in context, the systems paradigm holds is transportation system, there is a sewage system, there is a political system, there is a capital system. All of that come together, are overlaid with one another. And you look at the city as a series of systems, like the body with various breathing, working together, right? And if one system fails, it has consequences on the other, so on and so forth. But when you define it as power as the shaping element, or politics as the mechanism through which power is exercised and therefore shapes the cities, at least in the Indian context and perhaps even in the Western context, one would think that's a conflict paradigm, because political actors are always trying to maximize their sphere of influence or gain or what have you. And I feel like on Indian streets, it's the parking always fighting with the road. No matter how much you widen it, the parking occupies more of it, or pedestrians fighting, so on and so forth. Can you elaborate how, whether or your way of talking about power as shaping the city is essentially another aspect of a conflict paradigm or not?
Yeah, I mean, that's really important, the notion of conflict. So here's where I think pragmatism is very inspiring and insightful. So what they would say, it's not really about conflict, but difference. That because conflict kind of presented as people are at loggerheads. They are just, you know, fighting. But democracy is messy, and that's one. Second is there could be different points of view along a spectrum. Doesn't have to be for or against. Doesn't have to be black and white. So what they say is don't be scared of difference, but learn how to have difference in conversation. Like, how do you include people and have these very messy arguments, which is the idea of what parliaments are supposed to be about. You know, well-functioning parliaments, they have debates and discussions, but they come to some sort of action. And the other thing about power and difference is you don't have to have complete agreement. That doesn't always mean majority is right, majority is sometimes wrong. But what would drive it are the kind of values we want to emphasize in our cities, which is like in a democracy that we want to be more inclusive. We want to look at the needs of those who are usually excluded. So coming back to the street, the road, I remember a few years ago I was driving with somebody in Mumbai, and as usual he was cursing everybody, like, oh, we were driving in a car, like, oh, these stupid people on the bike and the camel and this and that. And I realized the problem wasn't all those people, the problem was the car. That we design roads by US and UK standards where the car dominates, which is a tiny minority of our population. And it's I think that's a wonderful actually design exercise. I don't know if anybody has taken, like, how do you design roads for the Indian reality where there are people walking and motorcycles and scooters and rickshaws and all that? There's no easy answer, but I think it's a wonderful creative exercise. That's the Indian reality versus importing our standards from US or UK and then saying, these people, they're encroaching and this and that. That's not the Indian reality, right? So that's an example of power and difference where we use values that, yes, the pedestrians have as much right to use the road as the car, if not more. Because guess what? Walking is the cheapest, most energy efficient, most sustainable form of transportation. But I think we have to examine those values, what we prioritize, which kind of guides what we do. And these are sometimes tough decisions, I gather. But that's what I mean by create a political act, is how do you engage in these discussions and come up with kind of priorities and values that define who we want to be. Like, one of the definitions, people think democracy is about voting. That's just one part. Is to be inclusive and have everyone have a voice, especially those who may not be as privileged as those of us who are in this room. I think we have to, this comes back to the beginning of the talk, we have to examine what are the values. Like, when I see a city that's dominated by cars, I'm like, okay, the values implicit is, oh yeah, cars are more important than people, which is a terrible value. Did I answer your question? Sort of.
Hi. Fascinating discussion, and nice to meet you. I'm wondering if you've got a view about, is urban design capable for the 21st century, you know, in terms of what you've kind of described, and I guess in terms of my experience, the process is quite linear. It follows a cascade of choices, but it excludes, by its very process, a significant number of choices, particularly, I guess, from an urban design point of view. And it also excludes qualitative assessment. So in other words, it's increasingly difficult to link different sectors within urban design together.
I'm sorry, there's a lot of background noise. Could you hold the mic closer to your mouth?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just saying it's impossible to link in different sectors within the urban design spectrum together as a designer. So one might come to the point of view that urban design as we teach and practice it today is incapable of serving the 21st century. And particularly, as you mentioned with Cuthbert, if it's a political economy and if it's a second-tier profession, what is urban design? What is the role of the urban designer other than, you know, is it SimCity built?
Yeah, that's a good question. So this question of what is urban design capable of doing and not doing, and what is urban design? My answer to that is I think it's a good question to ask, but we don't need an answer. I think these kind of very simple one-line answers are actually dangerous because they kind of limit things. So what I would say is a couple of things. First of all, what I call urbanism, which spans architecture, urban design, policy, must be collaborative. There's no way we can accomplish everything we do on our own. That's why I think this old model must die, even in architecture, of the superstar architect who comes and, you know, talks about this and that. It must be truly collaborative because cities are so complex, you need many minds to make it work. Second, it must be transdisciplinary. I don't mean interdisciplinary, but transdisciplinary. There must be multiple disciplines represented in that collaboration, including some of the people that we mentioned earlier, like lawyers, ecologists, economists. For the parking example I gave you, we were fortunate to have a fantastic transportation planner and who we relied on. We had a fantastic public economist, and it has to be a mutual process. The third thing is, I think, more than what is urban design, the question should be, what are we trying to achieve with every project we work on? And for me, even if we don't achieve it, the goal should be fundamental transformation. Of course, it's beautification, you know, responding to the client, but it needs to go beyond that. So we have to find different ways of using the project and the design to really, like some of the examples I gave you, more fundamental changes than just spatial or aesthetic. At the back.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful talk. In your presentation, you have said that thinking is the most powerful tool to transform cities. Can you elaborate a bit on it? And second thing is, you were saying that when you are explaining beyond intentions, we have to look for that. You should analyze the impact of your plan when it gets implemented. So, when, for example, today I make a development plan for a city or an environment plan, how a person should think of a future, that how my whatever solution I'm giving today will going to change things in practical. Because that is something very difficult for a student to visualize just at the moment of starting.
So absolutely. So the first part of your question is this notion that thinking is the most, I have no doubt about that, that our mind is the most powerful tool for transforming cities. So first of all, it's how we think about cities, so like theory. So this notion of smart cities, which is very sort of catching on all over the world, including India, really visualize the city as a machine, which is very efficient, very productive. It's sort of an economic model. So this notion of the city as an economic machine yields certain kinds of paradigms, that there should be economic investment, etc. Versus the paradigm, for example, you were saying, and this is a common paradigm people, especially on the left, envision, that city as a place of conflict. So if you think of cities as radically different theorizations of the city, you will practice in different ways. There's a third way, which, you know, kind of, which has been coming out of Europe and US, city as an object that is to be beautified. New urbanism is kind of part of that tradition, city beautiful movement, a lot of movements in the UK, you make it beautiful, but you don't really address political and economic structures. So those are very different ways of thinking. And what Lynch said in that quote is that we need to examine what are the values in that. So when you say smart cities, city as an economic machine, what are we valuing? We'll probably value those things that we think are productive, like corporations, like, you know, transportation, infrastructure, and probably we won't value so much where people live, how they go to work, you know, what the parks are, etc. So one is how we conceptualize cities, but the second way the mind is the most powerful tool for transforming cities is our creative thinking. I think I gave you some examples of how we can think about how a park becomes a job training program. But you have to kind of be very open to that. So, and I also gave the example, it's not about money, but how we spend the money. I'm sure you all know examples where, I can tell you many examples, where millions and millions of dollars have been spent on some utterly nonsensical project because it seemed right, somebody spent it. So it's not the amount of money. Like, I hear that a lot from people. Money is really important. Nonsense. And money is wasted every day. It's how we use it, how we leverage it, and so forth. The second part of your question is how we learn from consequences. I think a very important part of it is how, I think the most powerful source of that is history. How we teach and learn urban history. As you know, the old-fashioned way, architectural history, urban history, planning history, the old-fashioned way, which thank God is changing, is this great man, it's always a man, did this great thing, this great building, this great project. Oh yeah, Le Corbusier did that, yeah. But it's not a critical history, because critical history, then what happened? So when he built the Unité d'Habitation in Marseille, what happened after that? Chandigarh. I'm amazed, people still think, especially in the West, oh my God, Chandigarh. I'm not that impressed by Chandigarh. It's like, what are the consequences of Chandigarh? How have people adapted to it? How do they perceive it? How do they live it? So as a practitioner or as a student, you don't have to learn, but you can learn from history. Now, as a practitioner, you can learn from projects, something you did 10 years ago. And it's worth it. I see your point. As a practitioner, you're very busy. But if you want to improve your practice, learn from your own past. Like, go back to the project, observe, talk to people. It doesn't have to be an academic study. Spend a day. See how they are using it, what do they like, what they don't like. I'll give you a small example. Some of you might know this project by Peter Eisenman in Ohio State University called the Wexner Center, which is very revolutionary. It was kind of one of the first postmodern slash deconstructivist buildings, I think about 20 years old. And I was doing my master's in urban design, and I decided to do a paper on it. And I drove to Columbus, Ohio, and I asked the security guard, what do you think of this building? You think Peter Eisenman was thinking of the security guard? Mm-hmm. Not in his dreams. And he gave me the most surprising answer. He said, he loves the building. I said, oh, really? I didn't realize you were into deconstructivism and postmodernism. And I said, why? He said, well, you see that window, so from where he sits, I can see the sunset every day. I'm like, yeah, I'm sure Peter Eisenman was thinking exactly about that. But you can then use that insight that, you know, this poor security guard who has to sit there all day, what is his perception of the building? So you can, even as a practitioner, but I think as a busy practitioner, it's worth taking that time and revisiting. So one is a kind of critical history, and the other is kind of reflecting on your own practice. I think it's absolutely worth it.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation, sir. You said in your presentation that municipal budget can be a very powerful component while you are designing a project. So I just want you to share your experience that while you are making a municipal budget for the first time, and how it had become important for a project, powerful.
Wow, these are all really good questions. I'm happy to see CEPT students are still fantastic. Really smart questions. So yeah, that was a big surprise. So we had a contract to do that project, and something strange happened. So we were selected in a bidding process because we do things in a very democratic, transparent way. But then in the process, the city, the mayor, would kind of keep kind of putting up these hurdles and slowing us down. And we were like, what's going on? First you select us and then you don't let us do our work. And I realized in theory it sounds nice. Oh, it's democratic, it's participation. In reality, I don't think they were corrupt, but they were feeling very threatened, that they were used to making decisions, making deals with developers. I mean, for the city, again, I don't think they were corrupt. They were like, what the hell is this? They were not used to this radical way of designing. And then the final blow came. So let me, a couple of things it illustrates. This notion of who is the most powerful person or group who can influence this. This question of who has the power to either make this project successful, make it fail. In this case, it was very interesting. It wasn't the mayor, it wasn't the city council, it wasn't planning commission, wasn't even the richest guy in the city. It was a bureaucrat, city manager. I'm like, what's going on? And it was really interesting that everybody in the office said, we are finished. We've done our contract. Doing a budget is not in our contract. I was like, no, no, no. Like, I really believe in seeing a project through, not just making nice drawings and then walking away. And so I decided we are going to go through. So the way he was blocking us was like, he was asking, how much will this cost? How much will that cost? That's not, you saw the scale of, that's not part, that's his job. Budgeting is his job. I realized that was the tool he was using because he was feeling threatened by this process that the community loved. They loved it, but that was his way of controlling it. So we had this debate and we decided we're going to do the budget, we're going to charge them for it. So we charged them for it, we said. And the way we did the budget was me and this economist who knows a lot about design, I know a lot about economics, and we spent our time doing that. And anyway, long story short, finally the project got approved. It was amazing, it got an award, now they love it, etc. And I realized that there are these kind of strategic points of intervention, like a budget, like a policy, like power dynamics, in different contexts that can make or break a project. And a budget is a very powerful tool. And I'm sure you've heard about examples like, oh, we don't have the budget, or it's below budget, or it's too much budget. It doesn't mean we have to learn about budgeting, but I think we have to work with people who do understand that. And if the budget is the obstacle, how do we find ways to overcome that? So long story short, we found sources of funding. That's what he was asking. How are we going to pay for all this? I was like, again, that's his job. He's the city manager. So we did the research. We found sources. We did estimates, like even the parking garages I was showing you. I actually estimated the cost of every parking garage. He's like, here, you want this, take it. And that's what it took. So sometimes you have to not just say, oh, I'm just a designer, I don't know about this. We have to find ways, if we really believe in what we're doing, to make it happen. And budgets, as many of you know, are really crucial at the municipal level.
How you have prioritized the things?
In the budget. Yeah, that was a real discussion because they had different priorities, we had different priorities. Our priority was to make this a much more humane place. They were all about parking and cars and this and that. So we had a landscape plan, we had a street plan, we had a footpath plan for small businesses. So we want to make sure that our, what we felt were really important priorities were in there. And so we had to come up with funding for those. But I'll give you another concrete example. It's kind of a white middle class area, even though a lot of residents are poor and from Mexico and Central America. Because they're not in the power structure, they don't count. And I was very sensitive that these low-income people must be part of the process. So actually, I did something sneaky. Okay, this is going to be on video, but anyway, this was some years ago, I can admit it now, which was very undemocratic, but it was a good thing to do, was part of our plan they didn't want it was affordable housing for low-income communities. And we would discuss it, and they would say, no, no, we don't need. Even though they have thousands of them, they're like, nah, that's not our priority. And I would just put it back into the plan. And next meeting, they were like, I thought we got rid of it. What is it doing here? Sam, did you put it? Paul, did you put it? And I was just like, and they would take it out. Next meeting, I would put it back in. Like, Sarah, did you put that in? Anyway, long story short, now it is their official policy to support affordable housing. So, you know, it's called subversive practice. But only do it for good things. So So yeah, I mean, it was like my limit. I was like, okay, this is nonsense. I cannot let this happen. That you have thousands of low-income immigrants from South America who are doing all this hard work and that you don't acknowledge as part of your community. For me, that was unacceptable. So yeah, there are different ways you can do it. There's one more question here.
As I learned from your entire presentation that you said that the design or the worth of a project is quite a regenerative process. It goes on in the lifetime of that project. So there are various facets that it touches, like economic or social or even functionality and practicality. So when do we actually decide that a project is worthwhile or it is worth doing?
Another good question. Yes, good question. So again, the context is at the urban scale and in a democracy. So when it affects, this is what, again, what pragmatism teaches us, that in a democracy, what matters is maximum benefit to maximum people. So something like that transportation infrastructure project, the Big Dig, affects millions of people. So that's an example where it benefits a lot of people who use that, where I think we should pay more attention to those. Maybe smaller projects, not so much. I mean, you're right, you can't pay attention to every project. It's just impossible. So the way to prioritize is who will get the maximum benefit from which project. And I think we have to pay attention to those. Like, there's a lot of discussion, I don't know if this discussion is in India, but in the West, about public space. They're rediscovering public space, because those are the spaces where people come together to protest or to celebrate or something. Because there's, again, different people coming together. So I think, yeah, so that is one criteria, is like, who will benefit the most? Another criteria, which I really believe is really important, and I think there have been philosophers who've said this, the way to measure a society's success is not by how many millionaires and billionaires we have. Like, I know India has now more and more billionaires, but how we treat the poorest of the poor. How we, you know, help them get housing, education, transportation, jobs. So I think that's the other criteria. So one is maximum benefit, the other is benefit to those who need it most. Looks like somebody's plane just landed. Any other questions? Sorry? I think that's it then. Thank you very much. Sorry? I think that's it then. Thank you very much.